Belinda presents this unabridged recording of All I See Is Mud, written and read by Andrew Dunkley.
New Year's Day, 1917. I scribbled down the last few words of a letter. My hand was shaking as I wrote. It had to be just right.
The bearer, my son Stanley Dunkley, being in his 18th year, has my permission to enlist for active service. I then scrawled out the signature, Ernest Dunkley. I'd been practicing for a few weeks to get it right. I folded the letter, put it in an envelope, and stuffed it in my bag before seeking out my father. I knew he'd be angry, and that he'd try and stop me, but I was prepared for that. Dad was in his armchair, dozing after the night's celebrations. I don't know how much he'd had to drink, the same as any other day probably. His half-tucked-in, crumpled shirt was stained with the remains of last night's dinner and beer swill. He looked like he'd been there all night. I took a deep breath and said, "I'm joining up, Dad." It blurted out much harsher in tone than I'd planned. Dad jumped as my words broke through his slumber, and I watched as the message sank in. His jaw clenched, and his face reddened as a scowl exaggerated an already deeply furrowed brow. He lurched to his feet and looked at me through bloodshot eyes.
"The hell you are. I won't allow it. You're just a boy, and boys don't fight in wars."
Dad stared at me, expecting the usual backpedal. I'd been listening to his bluster and feeling his belt for 10 years now, and always feared reprisal, but I'd finally had enough. "You won't stop me. I've made up my mind." I fully expected him to raise his hand. That wouldn't have been unusual either. He stepped forward and shoved his face uncomfortably close to mine, his graying hair mopping beads of sweat from his forehead.
"I'll bloody well stop you if I so desire,"
he bellowed as I caught a rancid puff of his breath. We glared at each other, and I immediately felt a welling of nerves in my stomach and the adrenaline pumping through my arms and legs.
"I don't want to fight you, Dad. I'm going, and there's nothing you can do about it."
I felt terribly uncomfortable. I'd never stood my ground like this before, and he seemed utterly surprised by my defiance. Just then my younger brother and sister burst into the room, and Dad was quick to use them against me.
"What about Ruth and Eric? They need you here. You know I can't look after them."
I immediately felt terribly guilty about leaving them.
"Please don't do that, Dad. You'll just upset them. I'm not going to change my mind."
There was quite a pause as he pondered a new tactic.
"The army doesn't have time to play babysitter. Did you think of that? Men are dying over there. You don't stand a chance."
There was a wry smile on his face now, and I was about to say something smug when I noticed my siblings were weeping. It was a heart-wrenching situation. I had to get out of this place and live my own life, but leaving Ruth and Eric behind ate at my insides. I looked at Dad again and was about to speak, but he cut me off.
"Your older brothers are already over there. Surely this family's given enough to the war."
"That's beside the point, Dad. No one's keeping score. Can't you just accept that the decision is made? I'm going right now."
With that, I knelt down and gave my brother and sister a big hug.
"Don't worry, you two. I'll be home soon enough, with Harold and Alan."
I'm afraid I didn't sound very reassuring. I tried to stand, but they wouldn't let me go.
"Please stay, Stan," pleaded Ruth.
"It's all right," I said, as I broke away from their embrace. I looked at Dad again and thought I saw a tear glisten in his eye, but he wiped it away very quickly. His demeanour had softened a little.
"Don't be foolish, son. There's no need for you to go. You'll get yourself killed."
"I'm sorry, Dad, but I have to do this."
"Why, Stan? What possible reason could you have?"
"Duty, empire." I was really sprouting a lot of nonsense now. "It doesn't matter, does it?" The truth would have hurt him too much, and while I thought he was a terrible father, I wasn't going to tell him that he was the very reason for my decision.
"That's all good and well, Stan, but there's plenty of men over there already. They don't need to watch over a 16-year-old boy."
"Well, we'll soon see, won't we?" And I made for the door. Ernest grabbed my arm.
"Think about your mother. She'd have been heartbroken."
I looked at him square in the eye. "I know." And with that, he let me go. I looked at Ruth and Eric. "Be brave. Look after each other." They were crying uncontrollably now. I stood and offered my hand to my father. He looked at it and turned away, so I walked to the door, strode through, and gave it a good hard slam as I stepped outside.
As I made for the gate, I could feel his eyes burning into the back of my neck. I turned into Smith Street, Granville, and caught a glimpse of my father out of the corner of my eye. He was peering through the front window, but I fought off the desire to look at him. He started yelling through the glass, and I caught a few words, "You'll be back," or "Sent home," or something like that. I didn't really catch everything, but the message sank in, and I did wonder if the army might just turn me away at the gate. I walked briskly up the street, still feeling his eyes upon me, until I turned the corner and was quickly out of sight. I let out a sigh of relief and began to cry. As I walked, doubts buzzed around in my head. I wept a while longer, but wiped away the last of my tears as I approached Harry Robson's house. He was my best friend, and we'd agreed to join up together. We'd known each other since starting school, and he was waiting on the front step as I approached. But when I got a bit closer, it was clear that something was wrong. "What's up, Harry? Where's your bag?"
"Sorry, Stan, but I can't go with you. Mum and Dad came down pretty hard on me when I told them."
"What? You didn't stand up to them? Didn't you tell them I was going too?" But he didn't answer me, except to say he was sorry. I stood there, stunned, for a moment. Where did this leave me? It wasn't part of the plan. I never even considered that he'd back out.
"Well, this is a right old mess then, isn't it?" I suggested.
"I suppose it is. What'll you do now, Stan? Go home?" The thought was already at the front of my mind, but I'd finally had the guts to stand up to my father, and going back wasn't an option. If I'd inherited one thing from him, it was pride. Then something snapped in my mind. My thoughts became very clear, and I knew what to do. "Well, I think I'll just go on without you, Harry."
"What?"
Harry was visibly shocked.
"No, you can't go now. Wait until Mum and Dad come around. I'm sure I can make them change their minds in a day or two."
"Maybe. But I don't want to go home. It was hard enough getting out of there just now. I can't go back. I'll look like a fool, and he'll never let me out again. Sorry, Harry. I've got to go." He looked at me and then smiled.
"I understand."
Harry was a regular visitor to our house, so I didn't need to explain anything more about my father. "Bye, Harry."
"Goodbye, Stan. Keep your head down, or whatever it is you have to do."
"I will. Make sure you write me. Tell me what's happening back home. And drop in on Dad if you can. Make sure Ruth and Eric are okay."
"Will do, Stan. Goodbye."
And he waved as I disappeared up the street. My plans were in tatters, but I was carrying on. It was a long walk to Sydney Showground, and I didn't know what to expect now. Two of us wouldn't have attracted much attention, but a 16-year-old boy on his own might just invite some unwelcome inquiries.
I was more worried than ever, but I'd read about a boy that got in aged 14. I was hoping the letter I wrote would be enough to convince them that I was a genuine recruit. As I walked, my mind started swinging from one thought to another. I remembered my mother, Elizabeth. She died giving birth. The baby girl died also. I was only 7 at the time, and have only scattered memories of that terrible day, but I know my older brothers were devastated. Dad took to drinking, and our little corner store business suffered. Dad took his frustrations out on Harold and Alan, and then turned on me as I grew into my teenage years. When he finally met someone new, we all hoped it would be for the better, but we were wrong. She had her own son, also named Harold, and didn't want anything to do with us. Dad was smitten and we were a burden, so things just got worse. I hated leaving Ruth and Eric in that messed up place, but I couldn't stay a moment longer. My brother Alan was a good writer and sent us plenty of letters. I read as many as I could and was amazed by some of the stories he had to tell. Most of the mail was heavily censored, so they didn't go into a lot of detail when it came to military activities, but I was certainly swept along with patriotism. The truth is, the war gave me the perfect excuse to get out, and I grabbed it with both hands. Once I'd settled on my decision, I tried to keep up with the news of the war through the papers. They were always available at Sydney City Council, where I'd worked as an audit clerk for the last 2 years, after leaving school at 14. Just then I spotted a figure across the road. It was pretty clear he wasn't from Sydney. He wore a pair of dirty old trousers, well-worn boots, a long-sleeved shirt rolled up at the elbows, and a felt hat with the worst sweat stain I'd ever seen. He carried his swag over his shoulder and had the dark tan of a bloke who worked on the land. I thought he must have been about 40 years old. He'd already seen me and hurried across the road to catch up. "Joining up, young buck?" he asked. He was a fit-looking man and spoke with an odd country twang. "Yes, indeed. You too?" I inquired. "Too right. Don't know why I waited so long." He peered at me for a moment, and I knew exactly what he was thinking. "Geez, mate, you're a bit young, aren't you?" I felt the hair on the back of my neck bristle up, and I shot a scowl in his direction. He picked up on the message. "Well, doesn't matter, I suppose. You know what you're doing, by the looks of it." I took a moment to calm myself and replied, "Yes, I do." He skipped slightly to adjust the weight of his swag, which appeared to be quite heavy, but it wasn't slowing him at all. "The name's Tom Bower," and he offered me his hand. "Stan Dunkley," I replied, and he gave me a crushing handshake. We walked along, chatting all the way. He told me about his wife and two boys. He'd walked all the way from West Wyalong and had waited until his children were old enough to run the farm before joining up. Like my father, his wife was furious with him, but he was determined to be a part of the Great War. "So where do we go, Stan? I don't know my way around Sydney. Never actually been here before." "Really? Nope. You ever been to West Wyalong?" "Well, no. I've never been over the mountains." "Well, there it is then." And we both chuckled. I told him where we were headed. "There's a camp at the showground. I expect that's our best option." "Okay then, Stan. Lead the way." We walked for hours and really got to know each other well. He was a nice bloke and we really hit it off. He told me he was pretty good with a rifle and promised to teach me how to use one when we got our hands on them. "I don't know what those army blokes are going to tell you, but if you stick with me, you'll be a better than average shot." It was a hot day and all the shops were closed. There was no public transport running, so I was feeling the effects of the long walk. My feet hurt and a few blisters were starting to bite and the perspiration was running down my face, which I'm sure was bright pink. Tom, on the other hand, didn't appear to be suffering any ill effects. He gave me a quick glance and smiled, but didn't make any comment. After a while, we reached the gates of Sydney Showground. I could see rows of bell tents and a dried dust bowl where the grass used to grow, no doubt crushed under many hundreds of boots over the last few years. Guards stood at the gate with rifles slung over their shoulders. They were wearing khaki uniforms and slouch hats, but I got the impression it was only for show, as they didn't take much notice as we ambled through the gate. The first tent we came across was very large and had a sign above the entrance that said Recruitment. Tom lifted the flap and we both stepped through. The warm air was thick with the smell of canvas. There were a few desks and chairs dotted here and there, and a main desk where an officer sat scribbling notes. He looked up as we approached. "Good morning. What can I do for you today?" I felt a pang in my belly and became incredibly nervous. I was scared on so many levels. Would they see through my ruse? What if they sent me home? All sorts of doubts were in my mind. "We're here to join up," Tom announced. "My name's Tom and this here is Stan." "He's a fine-looking boy. You must be proud of him," suggested the officer. Tom let out an almighty laugh. "He's not my son, but he sure is a good bloke." The officer looked me up and down as I blushed. "How old are you, son?" I'd anticipated the question and made the mistake of answering so fast I almost cut him off. 18, sir." He still didn't seem convinced. Then Tom saved the day. "Stan was telling me he often gets told how young he looks. Must be hard for you sometimes, eh, Stan?" And I saw him wink. "Indeed. I have a letter from my father, if that helps," and rummaged around for the envelope. The officer looked it over, pondered for a moment, and finally said, "Here are some forms, so fill them in and bring them back when you're done. If there's something you don't know, leave it blank, and we'll sort it out later." And he handed over a wad of papers and a quill to each of us. We found a place to sit and began filling in the forms. The declaration required permission from the parents of anyone under the age of 21, so the letter was inspected and accepted without further question, much to my delight. Interestingly, there was nowhere on the form requiring me to state my date of birth. I wondered if that was an oversight or a very clever omission. We filled in as much as we could and were then shuffled off for a medical assessment. We were weighed, measured, had some basic medical tests done. Our bodies were checked for birthmarks and scars, which were noted on drawings of human bodies on our papers. "What's the point of that?" The doctor explained that these records would help identify us if we were killed, and our bodies were beyond recognition. The thought didn't sit well with either of us. Finally, the doctor jabbed me with a needle, and I winced in pain. "Sorry, son. Smallpox. You might feel unwell for a couple of days." My papers were then stamped fit for active service.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.